DarrenDeojee, everybody. Yeah.
Is this on? Do I need to flip this? Hello? Do I even need this? Can everyone hear me?
Yeah. You don't need that. You've got a loud enough voice.
Honestly, truth juice Birmingham. The only place where you get that sort of thing happening. Really, Mason watch everybody. If you want to be a Mason, they're hiring. That is actually true, because I heard something similar in Manchester, that there's a whole bunch of Masons leaving. So anyway, that's not what we're going to talk about tonight. I want to give you a bit of an intro to tonight, as usual. I've seen a lot of you before, but some of you haven't, so to those of you that I've never met before, hello, my name is DarrenDeojee. I do quite a range of different talks, workshops, campaigns, things like that. So I do stuff that's generally a bit different from what others look at, because it's so fundamental to what we do every day, we don't pay attention to it. So I do stuff on language, gender, sound, relationships. I also am involved with People's Public Trust, for those of you that may have heard of that. The whole sort of sovereign movement, that was one of my babies a couple of years ago, took up a lot of my time. And when I was deciding on what I was going to come here and do today, I spoke to you, this group here, quite a few times. And I thought, I'll do a bit more on language, I'll do a bit more on sound. And then I realised that as I was paying attention to what I'd been seeing going on in the world in the last sort of 6 to 8 months, that actually, maybe 8 months ago, I started to notice there was this massive cosmic dredge seeming to be going on for people, where all their emotional stuff was coming up, or things that they thought they dealt with many, many moons ago just seemed to be lifted into some kind of suspended animation that they were aware of. And it was manifesting in countless different ways, but it was in loads of people's lives that I was encountering. And I was just keeping an eye on that, and then more in the last sort of like 5 months, I've noticed that it seems to have been affecting a lot of relationships. And I've seen relationships either treading water, falling apart, often amicably, mind, but it reminded me of something and got me a bit back on track, really, because gender work and relationship work was something that I've been trying to do for about 6 or 7 years now, and I keep procrastinating about it because people always want to do other stuff. They don't want to be talking about the relationships. They don't want to be talking about things like that. It's a very taboo subject. It's also very difficult for me because I'm often in a room full of ladies and guys of all different ages, and for me as a somewhat youngish man to be presenting about the subject of gender, relationships and all the rest of it to people who may well be more experienced in terms of years on relationships, brought up my own personal stuff. So it kind of challenges me on my own comfort zone. And so when I was thinking about tonight, I thought, you know what, I'm going to dredge up the gender stuff, the relationship stuff, because it just seems to be needed. And after I made that decision, maybe a couple of weeks later, I found out about the Venus transit this year. So is anybody aware of the Venus transit?
No.
Well, I'm now fairly convinced Venus has kicked me up the backside to be doing this, because the Venus transit happens once every couple of hundred years, and basically it passes in front of the Sun twice in an 8-year period, and then it doesn't do it again for another 100 to 100 or so years. And so at the minute tonight, and you might have noticed the night skies recently, the last few days have been particularly nice, and this is because the brightest object in the sky is the first thing you'll see, and that is Venus. Right around, quite low in the sky at the minute, and up in the corner, the second object you'll see is Jupiter. And it's because Venus is lining herself up to go in front of the Sun on June the 6th. So I know that there's a festival set up specifically for it, which I will be guaranteed to be a great blast, called the Venus Love Fest, organised by a guy called Sunbird, who's behind the Sunrise Festival, Sunrise Off Grid and Waveform. So those of you who are familiar with that, I recommend getting yourself along to that. It'll be a blast. But I just want to mention that as a bit of a precursor as to where tonight's subject matter came from. So I've basically gone through all the talks that are booked for me for the next couple of months and said, right, you're all getting relationships, all of you. Because I think it's a really important point, though, because as a counterpoint to all of that, I've become very aware of how excited everybody is. You know, there's a real level of excitement, you know, a real intensity. There's a lot of, I don't know if people have noticed, a sort of shift going from 2011 to 2012, where things were manifesting pretty quickly and moving pretty dynamically last year, and I didn't expect the pace to increase like some people thought that it would, but my personal experience is that it has, and it has got quite a bit more intense. I'm enjoying it, you know, it's all great and all the rest of it, but I'm concerned about these big story bubbles that are flying around the place. And what I mean by that is that for every single person here tonight, Anything that you have not seen with your own physical eyes right in front of you or been involved in with your own hands is just a story. Okay, it's just a story. That's it. And for most people, their series of beliefs and their ideologies are people's stories that we relate to or don't relate to or buy into or don't buy into. And I just want to invite you to consider that tonight, because I think in these incredible times of manifestation and co-creation and amazing convergence, divergence, things turning up in minutes and days where they used to take weeks or years, I invite you to be very careful with whose story is in your head. Whose description of the world is there? Is it yours? Whose story are you repeating of the future? Whose vision is it? Are you talking about they doing this and they doing that and who's doing what, blah, blah, blah? Because whose plan is that? Whose vision is that? Is it yours? Is it your world? Is it yours? Is it yours? Or is it somebody else's? Because I think we're all being exploited in that respect for your co-creative powers. 12 people in a room cannot make disaster and fall a species. But if they can get everybody else to start repeating the story, even in a so-called positive sense, then alternative media becomes just as damaging as normal media. Because the alternative media, which is the so-called awakened, which means your thought-creating manifesting power is higher and more powerful than the average sleeping masses, then it's even more important what is going on inside your head. And so I really invite you to consider whose story is in your head. Whose world are you repeating on a daily basis? And I invite you to try and stake your claim to your personal space and to your state of being. Because if you think about it, your fundamental state is that of peace. If you're at home, you switch everything off, settle down, you have a relax. Is everything okay, generally? Is it? It is, isn't it? It's only when we start to let other stuff into our space that we're then moved from that state. And our challenge in life is realizing how much we've let things invade our space. And I see very much the challenge of our times as being that of actual space. It's space, abandonment, personal space, allowing each other space. And I think it's, we'll maybe get a chance to talk about that a little bit, about the significance of space as a sort of an element that we haven't addressed in terms of our elemental makeup. You know, people are very aware of their earthiness, their wateriness, their fireiness, things like that. People aren't as aware of their space. And space is something that is very important for us in terms of being able to manage our internal state of peace. And certainly when you're under more onslaught now than you've ever been. And not only that, in fact, as our species, you personally are under more onslaught at this stage of our species than any preceding generation in terms of the amount of stuff you're bombarded by. It's incredible. And the only way you can manage it is by managing your personal space. And most of us aren't that great at it. So what we're looking at tonight is a bit of something that can help towards that, but it's not corely about that. I do other events on perception and perception management, which is much more about space management. If anybody's interested in that, you can give me a shout later. But it did have to be mentioned because I think it's part of what's going on for us right now, and it's a significant tool for us. Now, in terms of this onslaught of information that's coming at us, I believe that we are the most mentally excited brand or generation of our species ever. And I think it's because here in the West we are actually the sort of the mental explorers of the species, just as in the East they were the emotional explorers. And we've got to a stage where in our culture and our society, the stories can't really get much bigger. Okay? They can't. I mean, look at people's expectations for this year. Can they get any bigger than the end of the year? What? You know? Everything from aliens to ascension to invasion to World War III, which is fairly likely compared to some of the others, terrorist attacks, you know, whatever else, you know. But I mean, can they get any bigger? How bigger a story do you want? And then, you know, how much are you buying into those stories, though? That future promise. How much are you resting your faith and your trust and your belief and your hopes and your actions today on that future unknown? Because my concern is that if, and I do mean if, the bubble that you've bought into doesn't manifest, how will you feel in February 2013? Where will your feel-good factor be if your ascension didn't happen, your aliens didn't happen, blah, blah, blah? Will you be okay? Now, the stuff I do is very much about being okay with all the mental excitation stuff, but I think this has all happened as a result of the internet and television. And if you think about it, I mean, do we have one here? We don't. Right, okay. Has anybody got a phone on them or something like that? Yeah, phone. Okay. I press the button. I just switch it off. Anybody got a phone that's off? Thank you. Perfect. Okay. Everybody, if you have a look at that for me. That is the fundamental state of all technology. What are you looking at? you made me look. You're looking at nothing, a black screen or a grey screen or whatever. Yeah. So what happens is the what I consider to be the real Illuminati, which is about the most the flame effect that it has to us when we give this a bit of electrical life, and what that does to us, how that affects us, you know, how it draws us. Sorry, I'm handing your phone out there. Sorry, I apologise. Should have put the hint there. but that's something that we, as the last couple of generations, were the only ones that have been subjected to that. And it is literally like moths to a flame. You know, we're drawn to, how many, in my perception events, I talk about defeating television, which is where you can be in a room and it's just as important as a wallpaper. Because for most of us, you walk in and what happens is that magnetic pull. Now, we're being stimulated when we're exposed to that sort of stuff. Mentally, emotionally, people buy into their emotions, they'll charge it up and all the rest of it. And my concern is the level of mental excitation that's come in from the internet, because we call it the net, we call it the web. When we're plugged in, okay, and I really want you to pay attention to those terms. I've been going on about it for over 10 years, that we have to be careful with the net and the web, because we think with the net that we're the fishermen going, yeah, cast my net out and I'm in control. But are you? I mean, how many of you are now spending more time online than you are out and about with your neighbours? So are you in the net or are you mastering the net? Are you the spider dancing along the web or are you the fly stuck in it? And it's just a rhetorical point of consideration to say, okay, what is going on in here, and are you just feeding your story bubble larger than your emotional and physical reality can cope with? Because say the system falls, say the system does go this year, okay? Now if the system falls, so it doesn't matter how it happens, right? It really doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. Electromagnetism, solar flares, aliens, bombs, irrelevant. It doesn't matter. The point will be, if your power goes off, if the shops are empty, if the phone doesn't work, who's going to be there for you? Is it going to be your codenamed mate off a forum? You don't even know what he looks like, but you know, you've got that deep connection because you're brothers. But you wouldn't know from Adam if you saw him. Or is it going to be your neighbour? He's outside. And how are you at relating? Can you actually speak to them? Do you even know their names? Do you smile at them? Where's your humanity for them on a daily basis? Groups like this are doing really well around the country because it's a safe place to come and be human. And the problems that people are facing in the world is a reducing experience of humanity from the organisations that we deal with, from the authorities around us. And we're concerned, it's like, oh, so it's affecting our emotional state, and we're turning more and more to like-minded people. And we're forming these distant communities where you have to travel to be with those people. And that's great, that's fine. But I think it's lulling us into a sense of security when we're maybe not dealing with a lot of our issues, again, to do with the excitation. So we're being excited, we're finding the like-mindedness, that's great. But really, do we have the emotional maturity and wherewithal to back it up? And the answer, no, for some of you is yes. But no, for others, it's like, well, it's maybe something we have to visit. And that's where, for tonight, I wanted to draw and make the subject about relationships and about arming ourselves to deal with relationships. Now, it's a massive, massive subject, and the way that I approach it is different from how you may have heard it before, which is usual for my events, for those of you that are familiar with it. So the reality is, we're going to run out of time. The reality is, we're not going to cover it all, but hey, such is life. We'll get through as much as we can. And we'll just take it from there, and I'll take questions at the end if that's okay, just so that we can try and keep on track. Because I know what you hecklers are like here in Birmingham, honestly. Yeah. So basically, just as all this excitation starts going on, my main concern is the erosion of foundations continues. Okay, and by erosions of foundations, I mean our community. and our sense of what community actually is and where is it and all this sort of stuff. And I find it interesting that there's a much stronger sense of community amongst migrant and ethnic minority populations than there is amongst the natives here in the UK. It's a very interesting thing. So you tend to find actually in some of the most poorest and run-down areas of the cities, you'll find actually the strongest sense of actual community and connection. It's a very, very interesting sort of thread that you can spot around the country. Now don't get me wrong, in rural UK as well, there's a fantastic sense of community still going on, but in terms of this humanity stuff, you know, in terms of that human connection, how are we in that respect? And I invite you all to consider, if you're standing there upset at the way you're being treated inhumanely by corporations or by governments or by whatever, I invite you to consider, where is your humanity on a daily basis? How human are you with the people you walk by and when you're standing in the shop and when you're doing different bits and bobs? Are you giving them the cold face or are you giving them your human presence? And then do you have any right to demand humanity from others when you're withholding it from others for 80% of your day? Just rhetorical questions. An invitation. And it really is an invitation because I can't stand here and dictate, I can only invite. And it's just trying to read between the lines a bit about what's going on and say, yeah, okay, let's be excited, let's have all the hope and the possibility and all the rest of it, but let's also look at everything that's going on if possible. And the subject of relationships is an interesting one because everybody tends to avoid it. I mentioned earlier I avoid it because it pushes us out of our comfort zone. Because who's got a perfect relationship? Who feels they can stand there and talk about relationships? And theirs is so good and so shining an example that they can then pontificate about how relationships work. I certainly don't feel that way. That's why I've not done it for years. But, you know, that's why the event, you know, you lot know what I'm like. It's all about wordplay. It's all about spells. For those of you that don't know me, most of my work is based on spelling. It's about we spell all our words because all our words are really spells. And it's all about the magical effect that they have on our awareness and our being. But I also think that's a way for us to understand something very simply. So actually, somebody asked me tonight, do I have healthy relationships? And I said, well, it's an interesting question because I don't think healthy relationships is a destination. I think it's a process. And that's why the event is called Heal Thy Relationships. It's an ongoing thing. We're looking at the words that we're using every day, and healthy, I see to be healed by. You know, and I think the process that we're in is the process of healing various aspects of our relationships of all levels, because it's all a reflection of your relationship with yourself. There's only one of us here. Does everybody get that, grasp that concept? There's only one of us here. Okay, we're soul, S-O-L-E, there's one of us. It's just that we've got different forms for the fun of being. But all your various relationships at different levels, so children, partners, friends, colleagues, family, they all represent different aspects of your relating with yourself. And that's why you will be different with each of those things, with your kids, with your friends, with your family, with your partner. You might switch on different modes for each of them. Does everyone relate to that? Yeah, so you have different aspects of it. This is how we manage our vulnerability and our fragility, and how we manage our internal space. For those of you that have done the spelling talk before, you know that very much the management of our internal space is about misdirecting people with spells that point elsewhere. So when you see something's wrong, you ask how you are, and people say what? They say I'm fine. And what they're doing is they're directing you away from their internal reality. And this is what we're doing in our relationships all the time. And it's what we do with our humanity. We dish it out to those that we want to. We dish it out to people that we like and we feel safe with, but then we withhold it from others. And it's a very, very interesting thing to watch and just be honest with, because this is very much about our relationships. And everything that we do is about, you know, it's so funny how, you know, people will be, they'll save their spirituality till 7 till 9 in the yoga class on a Tuesday night, or 11 till 1 at church on a Sunday, you know, but it's off the cards at work from 9 till 5, it's not even part of the conversation. It's like, well, it's part of your identity, or isn't it? And then who's schizophrenic? Do you know what I mean? Who's mentally ill? Because you know we're all doing it. We're all different. We're all keeping different parts of ourselves. Well, this is the work me. This is the home me. This is with friends me. This is when I'm by myself me. This is with the kids me. You know how many eyes have we got? Two. That's more than enough. So anyway, on to the substance of this evening. That was my introduction. So yeah, I feel like Venus has given me a bit of a kick up the backside, so I'm going to blame her for this evening. Those of you that see me speak before as well, you'll know that I don't normally use notes, but I'm not out of my comfort zone on this one tonight. I've got the old notes scribbled down. Okay. Right, we have this interesting thing, and I think, just to finish, the Venus point and why I'm doing these talks just now is, I think we very much have to exploit the energies of the times. We're up against so much that if we can tap into anything that might make things a bit easier or smooth the way in one particular area, then I think we should embrace it and grasp it. And that's why I've done this with the Venus Transit, because, as I said, the foundations of culture, society, community, I believe, are continuing to be eroded while we're paying more and more technology to the top-end stuff like technology and blah, blah, blah. And it's only so long before that can tumble, and we need to relearn our basic skills again. I know most of you are all very familiar with that. But I think there's endemic hurdles, especially in the arena of relationships, that make it very difficult for us to address it, and that's exactly what we're going to look at tonight. But what do I mean by this sort of endemic hurdles? Because I think this Venus transit is loosening the effects of those a little bit. And I'm trying to exploit that with you guys tonight and hopefully give you a few tools to run away with. So by endemic hurdles that I think we're facing in a gender sense, in a relationship sense, I'm going to have to give you a bit of a background, as you might guess. So, has everybody heard the concept of being yourself?
Yes.
Okay. Sounds easy, doesn't it? Just be yourself. Just be yourself, everyone. Be yourself. Be yourself. What could be easier? Just be yourself. Well, most people don't even know what the self is. And actually, they spend a lot of their life not being themselves, which is actually the cause of most conflict and problems and blah, blah, blah. And then the search for self takes over for a while. But we've been misled in this quest for the being of self, because you don't just be the self. Because you can be the self sitting on be yourself sitting watching the telly for 25 years, eat McDonald's every day, and, hey, I'm being myself. Brilliant. Oh, well, the epitome of spiritual accomplishment then, sir. Fabulous. But no, we know that's not the case. So it's not just about being yourself. You see, there's a process. And actually, we recognise that in one of our words, one of our spells. And that is, you don't be the self, you become it. You become yourself. And this is actually a representation in language, or in spelling, of the balance of the gender poles, which is the being, which is the feminine, the accepting. It's okay. But then there's a part that we don't really like to talk about, and that's the coming, which is the masculine. And the funny thing is, we've had a lot of stuff in recent years about the reconnection with the divine feminine, because it's been neglected and blah, 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 and all the rest of it. And that is absolutely true. But the problem is, the masculine has been just as neglected and abused and brutalised and all the rest of it. And we're going to look at that quite a bit tonight as well, because we need to heal both. We need to understand both aspects and where they're at play. Your being and your coming, and what that actually means. Some people would say being and doing. Being and doing isn't it. Coming is different, because what it leads to is the coming of the soul, which is something completely different. And it's about us talking about sex and getting into the most taboo subject that our society doesn't want us to deal with. For the last 100 years or so, there's rarely been such a castigated subject as sex, sexuality, and all the rest of it. Now, sadly, because it's a public event, I didn't have enough time to put the word out that it's sort of adults-only sort of thing. I've had to censor out the grittiest parts of the sort of subject of gender and relationships, which is just has to be that way. But that's fine. There's those of you that are interested can go on and study that at a later event with me. But we'll be able to go into sort of like the outskirts of it tonight and hopefully give you enough fuel to go away with something that you can work on. So it's a bit of a tricky subject, the whole becoming and being and coming, because it's very abstract. And so gender is like an energy that's at play 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and you're not aware of it. Most people have gone through their life completely unaware that this thing has been responsible for the success or failure of their relationships, and communication and all the rest of it. And I've been 24 hours a day. It's like having a set of chakras you didn't know about. And all of a sudden you woke up and you're like, bloody hell, there it is. And hopefully tonight you're going to get a sense of the fact that, oh, that's where they are. Because it's, you know, chakras are dead easy to grasp. You know, is everybody familiar with the concept of chakras? No? Okay, so chakras are presented as being the energy centres in the body in the east.
Oh, chakras.
Yes, chakras, yeah. Now the thing is, even if people don't grasp energy, you can tell them about the sensitive areas in their body where the chakras are kind of seated. And people can grasp that, you know. It's dead easy in that respect. But when we're talking about gender, we're talking about something that's so abstract, you can't actually know what it is. You can only refer to its effects. Okay? Now that is true of all abstract things. And I want to give you an example of that right now. So I want everybody to lift up your left arm for me, please. Okay. And now I want you to slowly put it back down again. Beautiful. Now I want you to tell me, how did you do it? Sorry? Did you?
Will.
Just fill in the space, mate.
Just will it to happen.
It's intent. Exactly. And intent is exactly what we're referring to here. Gender is like intent. You can't see it, you can't know what it is, but you can witness its effects. Because you just witnessed the effects of intent there. And that was how you learned to walk, it's how you learned to talk, it's how you learned to do all the really proper, juicy stuff in your life that you pay no attention to. Take for granted, and it's actually where the real keys to your awareness, power, total awareness and everything lie, is in those little things that you pay no attention to. Incredible. But so with gender, what we're going to have to do is look at some of its effects to get a grasp of what I'm talking about. So let me see. So we have this kind of concept that we're all the same in spirit, don't we? We have this thing that, you know, we're all the same in spirit, it's fine. And this is, I think, what's given rise to the whole abandonment of gender and manifest sex as being a subject matter that people are willing and comfortable to talk about. So it's like, well, it's all right, it doesn't matter whether you're a man or a woman, we're all the same in spirit, it's fine. They think, well, yes, that is true, but then why are we manifesting as one or the other then? What's that all about? Why are we not talking about that anymore? And this kind of taboo thing has just done nothing but stingers all the way along. Now, I just went. So there's a couple of things here that lead to it. I'm trying to say which one is going to be the best to get us to the point here. So if you imagine that we are all the same up there or in our energy self or whatever, we're obviously choosing to manifest as a sex for a reason. It's actually to do with a particular set of tools, to do with, you know, what you want to achieve in life. Now, can everybody grasp that, at least hypothetically, as a possibility before we proceed, that your manifest sex was a choice in some way? Mm-hmm. Everybody sort of okay with that? Even if you're not, if you can hypothetically accept it, then we can move on. So really, it's like, you know, a hammer for a hammer's job, a screwdriver for a screwdriver's job. This is pretty much what we've done, choosing our manifest sex to come here. But it doesn't mean you leave one of your other half away. You know, people talk about their other half, don't they? Oh, where's my other half? Oh, I'm waiting for my other half, or blah, blah, blah. Well, your other half is right here. It's actually referring to our other gender half. That's why it used to also mean referring to your partner, because that would be the manifestation of that other half. But that quest for wholeness never actually yielded wholeness, because we're all whole and complete. And it's just a reflection, our relationship with our partner is just a reflection of our connection with our other aspect of self. And this is what it is to become whole. Now, so what's happened to us is that our toolbox of gender has fallen behind the rest of our spiritual awareness and ongoing development and all the rest of it. And what's important now is if we have a look at how that's happened and what's gone on. So if we imagine this as being like the gender timeline, where this is now, and it's been going on for hundreds of years where the genders have been undergoing change. Now, if we say things, if we go back to the time of the suffragettes, or just before the suffragettes, the transition of gender has been going on eternally, okay? The development and cultivation of what it is to be male, what it is to be female, etc., and what it is to become whole. But things start to get a bit messy post-industrial revolution, because something went wrong with the gender poll, something went wrong with the gender energy itself, and it was to do with the men not moving on beyond the structures that they had formed in the Victorian period. And then what happened was the women obviously started to resist what was going on there and saying, well, actually, you're stifling us, you're not letting us into the rest of the world, blah, 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 because you weren't getting the workplace, they weren't getting in, you know, into vote, they weren't getting access to all these developments of the little boys club that had been created. So we had the beginning of the suffragettes movement, so it's suffrage, which really was just the culmination of hundreds of years of a women's movement that had already started. Now, if we see what started to happen as we move along here, because after around the time of the suffragettes, we also had the First World War. So we had World War I coming in, which people tend to view as quite a negative thing, but actually had a very, very positive spiritual purpose. And what was happening was the decimation of the male gender model, because the Victorian male model had become too stagnated and it had to be decimated. Now, there was both a negative effect of this as well as a positive one. Now, the negative effect was the loss of a lot of practical people and a loss of historical practical know-how. You know, that's why men of today tend to be a little bit less practical than we used to be. But it's been part of this journey. Now, if we say that men and women have both within them, yeah? I'll just use this symbol because most people are familiar with it, okay? And what was happening was that the maleness in women was being strengthened with the suffragettes movement. Now, if I draw the line in the circle to represent masculine and feminine, okay, this is all to do with the dynamic energy of the male, which is why he tends to be quite powerfully built and why he will tend to be spent sooner than a woman will be. And it's all to do with handling the energy of the unknown. That's why men are all about the spark. They tend to be the first explorers. They tend to be the first discoverers of particular things because they handle that first burst of the unknown. And then after that, women always tend to do better than men do at a particular thing. And if we look back throughout time, all the behaviours which psychology have attributed to role, so by that I mean women staying at home and men being the hunter-gatherer and all the rest of it, or men going out and hunting and patrolling the boundaries and all the rest of it, that was actually a result of the gender urge, of actual gender energy manifesting itself in particular behaviours. And this continued over time to the extent where what was happening was men were supposed to be continually, you know, defending the perimeter, defending the boundary and all the rest of it, and then bringing back all the new stuff to the women. Okay, they're meant to be bringing that back, and then the woman has to find, you know, space for it in the known. That's why women tend to be much better multitaskers, why they tend to be much better at organising things on a daily basis and all the rest of it, is because of the gender qualities that they have. So you almost have one representing the known and the other representing the unknown. Okay? So your men are supposed to be continually out exploring, bringing back new stuff. And this is what went wrong in the Victorian era. The men stopped. They got their little boys' club going on. They were happy with their mental achievement, and instead of busting through to the next realm, which was the realm of soul, energy, spirit, blah, 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 they stagnated. We're obviously now at the end of that journey. We're all more connected to those things. But at that time, that wasn't the case. Women were boxed in, they were stuck. You know, they didn't even have access to everyday society, let alone all the other fruits that men were enjoying. So the masculinity in women was strengthened first. So what women were doing was they were pushing this boundary out. They were saying, oi, you buggers, you're trying to keep it all to yourself. And not only that, we can handle everything you've given us. This is easy. Look, we've managed it all. Look, multitasking, it's managed, everything fine. This isn't enough. And so they started to push out to lay claim to the workplace, to the voting arena, to blah, 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 through the suffrage, to expand the knowing of human consciousness, to take us forward in our evolution. So, it's me kicking it that's causing it. Sorry, yeah. It's just my vandalism. No, it's not the stable.
Some Gamboa in
there. No, it's me. It's that's it. It's just... No, it's the trying to pull through something that's so abstract. That's why, you know, it's a very difficult thing to convey. So, the women were pushing out against that to say, right, we can handle all of this, we can make this a norm, we can organise all of this. Now, the problem was, yeah, you had some men on side, that was fine, but a lot of men weren't. And this is where the decimation of the model started. So World War I decimated a whole bunch of men because you had, obviously, mainly European men, but you had whole school, whole classrooms of guys signing up and going off to the trenches and then just being wiped out, literally just running up and just being mowed down. Okay? All that practical knowledge, all that experience, all that male behaviour eradicated. So where were the boys? Where were they? Where were the kids?
With their mums.
They were with their mums. So what happened then was the beginning of, so this over here, what we had was the masculinity of the female, masculinization, beginning first. But then you had the feminization of the male by letting them be brought up by their mums. So then what we had was, after World War I, we had this real ebullience, this outbreak of, you know, that sort of Charleston-esque sort of funky time of people coming out and being a bit more emotional, being a bit more emotionally present. There was a bit more celebration happening, more emotional expression, already a shift from traditional Victorian idealism. But it wasn't enough. That went on, that went for one generation and one generation only until we hit World War II. When the models took their next blow. And what, if you look at the symbology of women across this century, it's an amazing how the image changes from the demure Victorian suffrage lady who may chain herself to a railing to make her point, to the World War II imagery of the woman with the knotted handkerchief and, you know, standing like this, posing, you know, I'm out, I'm working, I'm making weapons, brilliant, and managing the house. Yeah. You know? Because that was the point, though. The point was that they did easily embrace and manage it and get out there and take it on board. But what a far more masculine image, isn't it? Much more. And it was because of the gender transition that was taking place. Now, as this continues, again, where were the boys? The boys were at home with an even stronger masculine maternal image. Yeah? This made the boys even more feminine. And so in the post-World War II era, we had a burst of gender confusion, relationship breakdown, and community breakdown like we've never seen in the history of our species. It was incredible. Gender confusion, and, you know, by the time we hit the 60s and the 70s, they called them swinging because people were swinging all ways. You know, it was an incredible period in time. And this is all a result of the eradication of traditional gender role. And off the back of World War II, where basically, we were pretty well white-collar urbanized by that point. There was a bit of blue-collar left. We kind of started to lose that through the 70s and 80s, and most of our blue-collar has now moved abroad. And pretty much most people are involved in white-collar work. By that, I mean office work or computer work these days. That's what most people are involved in. There's far less practical work going on in this country. Now, that's part of this mental excitation process. But in terms of watching our relationships, specifically families, specifically marriages, specifically community, if we look at those things, because they're all a direct expression of gender and relationship energy, if we look what's happened to them in the post-World War II era, it really changed. Does everybody see that to some extent? Okay? So what we had, now, a lot of people, obviously what you had was, you know, say the gay movement back in the late 70s, early 80s, you would have them going about, well, there's always been this many gay people, it's always been like this, we're just coming out now, we're just letting it be known. Well, you know, I challenge that. I don't think that was the case. I think it's actually a product of the gender transition that's been taking place. And this has had to take place because A, we were all imbalanced, and B, to be able to manifest stable soul awareness, stable higher self, stable divine consciousness, the gender poles within you must be balanced. Because if they're not, there's no foundation there. You'll be unable to relate. You'll be incomplete because you're still looking for your other half. That's no good. Soul can't operate there. It can give urges and whatnot, but no more. So where we are now here is a place where anybody can do most of the jobs, man or a woman. So what are men for? What do they do? What are women for? What do you do? What is it to be a woman? And what is the role of a woman in a relationship? And what is it to be a man anymore? And what's the role of a man in a relationship? And really, we don't know the answers to that. But what we are not aware of is the fact that it is a question that we should be consciously addressing, because we are in the midst of a massive gender crisis and a massive relationship crisis. If we don't get a handle on it, then yeah, you know, in 20 years' time, we may well all be, you know, occasionally bumping into each other to arrange for, you know, a test tube baby because the population's a bit down because we can't relate with each other anymore, we can't stand in each other's space. So what's happened is, because it's become taboo, it means that our gender knowledge and our relationship knowledge has not kept pace with the rest of our awakening. So as we're awakening, we're not sure how to transform our relationships to match and to suit, and to handle new levels of intimacy, new levels of mental awareness, new levels of all the rest of it. How do we make that happen? Okay. Well, how are we doing for time? Is the time?
You've got 15 minutes.
15 minutes for break.
15 yeah. minutes, 20 minutes.
Okay, I can hear tired minds out there. Men have a bit of a challenge for them these days, and so do women. And to get a handle on how we can see how this is manifesting in our relationships, we have to talk about balls. Now, we're not going to talk about sex, we're only going to talk about balls just now, but it's because gender is really all about balls. It's about balls on the outside and balls on the inside. The same force gives rise to both. Okay? Now, this is where, you know, earlier I talked about gender being at play 24 hours a day, all the time. It's got nothing to do with your manifest sex, it's got to do with the energy of what's going on at the time. So, where are a man's balls? On the outside, pointing out. Where are a woman's? On the inside, receiving. It's actually about communication. It's about transmission, reception. It's about pointing out and receiving. And that is actually the essence of what's happening in our communication. So, if we say that in all interactions, somebody is always in the male role. Always. And the one that's in the male role is the one that's pointing something out. So in any conversation, the gender can change all the time by the one who's pointing something out. So in any conversation, you could be taking on the male role and pointing something out to me for a while, or I could be taking on the male role and pointing something out to you. But what's really interesting is that these days, most people don't balance that. And everybody's over-masculinized. Everybody wants to point out to everybody else all the time. Nobody wants to be in their female and listen, except in situations like this where you pay for it. The rest of the time, sitting around the coffee table, everybody wants to be the pointer. Do you relate to that? Because often what happens is, people are just waiting for their turn to talk. And this is decimating. That simple thing there is annihilating relationships all over the planet. It's just about knowing when it's appropriate to be in which mode. When is it appropriate to be receptive and accepting and listening? And when is it appropriate to actually be drawing the line and defining the point and saying, actually, I'm defining the boundary here and saying, actually, I want to step in here and point something out. And when is it appropriate to do each? It was worth it getting there, wasn't it, eventually, to get the point. You know, it's a very, very simple point. And this is just the beginning of the subject, because it's massive. It's a massive subject. Because really, with as above, so below, microcosm and macrocosm, every lower correspondence you learn about yourself has a higher meaning and arms you for that higher meaning and delving with it in that realm. What we've forgotten or don't know is actually that the lower correspondence of sex and relating is a lower correspondence of communication at higher levels. And so that's why we're actually struggling a lot with some of the higher communication, because actually we haven't even mastered the lower stuff yet. And in terms of this erosion of foundation I was talking about earlier, I've just felt this powerful, you know, kick up the backside to be directing people's attention back to their everyday relating and the appropriateness of how they're conducting themselves in it. Now, to help us understand, now that's actually just the communication side. There's more to it than that. I'm going to, just before the break, we're going to look at the archetypes that make this easy for everybody to see. So we're going to just check, has everybody here had a relationship at some point in their life? Yes, excellent. Right, and by that I mean with a partner, yeah? Okay, so the male and the female sides have a name, an archetype to help us grasp it a bit easier. So let's do the easy one first. The female in a woman is called a woman. And the male in a man is called a man. Excellent, that was the easy bit. But the male in a woman is called the mother. And this is because, we'll talk about children in a moment, and the female in a man is called the boy. And this is because gender is relative. It's got nothing to do with your manifest sex, nothing. It's relative, so at any point in time, you could be a he or a she relative to somebody else. We're all feminine relative to the soul, because it's the one trying to point stuff out to us. See what I mean? And then, but children are always feminine relative to their parents. Because the parents are always the ones pointing stuff out to them, defining the boundary, managing the territory, bringing the new information in, all the rest of it. It's a masculine function, it's a masculine energy within us. So I mean, to get a handle on that, if you think that, you know, the feminine within us is the part that can accept everything, that everything's perfect right now, everything's okay, so in this room, everything's absolutely fine and perfect and beautiful as it is. But the masculine, and you might say, but it could be a bit warmer. Or actually, it would be nice if the lights were a bit brighter. Yeah? So this is how these two qualities play off within all of us all the time. This is what I mean, you're all whole and complete here, your masculine and your feminine are both here and playing right now. But when you were kids, you weren't pointing anything out to anybody, okay? You were always receiving because you didn't have anything yet. And that's why the mother is a masculine in the woman, because she's always masculine relative to her kids. Now, what's interesting is that those archetypes are real and true. So that in a relationship, as an adult, if the man is not being in his male, in his man, then somebody has to be in the male role, and the woman can't help but mother him. And he can't help but behave like a boy. Now I've got your attention. And you'd have to wait to that point. There's always a struggle to get to that point, but everybody gets that. Because then, when that happens over time, nothing but resentment can build. And unless we can get a handle on the mother and the boy, our relationships are screwed. Because the gender challenge that's up against us now is that men, the boy in them, is up against a super masculinized mother, a hyper masculinized woman. But the problem is the men have been so uber feminized and had all of their behaviors castigated and judged and abused. Because men, it's all men's fault. They're the pedos, they're the bullies, they're the rapists, they're the violent ones, they're this, that, and the other. Boys for the last four generations have grown up in a climate of being blamed for everything. And what it means is that when the energies move through them, the make them want to bring about change, they are fearful and they switch off to it or they disown it. Or what happens is it's throwing the baby out with the bathwater. They don't realise they're throwing behaviour and energy out, not really realising that the energy can be translated into new behaviours. And that's really what gender work is about, relationship work is about. But anyway, and this is another interesting thing to do with the challenge that's ahead of us all. This is why women mature faster than men. Because for a woman, she is a female at birth and as a child, but also as an adult. So she doesn't have to go through the same transition that a man has to go through. Because a man has to go through the transition of being feminine to being masculine. And that used to be recognised in cultures around the world with rites of passage. And we got rid of that. So now we don't even know. You don't know when you're a man anymore. It's an arbitrary age, which is crazy, isn't it? Absolutely crazy. It doesn't denote anything. The age of your body does not denote how much of a man you are. But anyway, on that note, we'll have a break, digest the mother and boy thing for a moment, and then we'll come back. I'll speak for about another half an hour or so and then take questions or whatever. Thank you for your attention. I appreciate it. Excellent. Thank you everybody for coming back. That's usually the first thing that's worth thanking people for, not everybody does, so yeah. Step one, let me just turn this over. Okay, so I usually like to let whatever people come and talk to me about in the break kind of fuel the second part. So I'm still digesting because people spoke to me incessantly. Right, so, yeah, good old Birmingham, honestly, you are. Right, so This has obviously hit a bit of a nerve, the mother and boy thing. And that really is actually just the beginning. All we've done is done the beginning. We've not even actually got into the gender model yet. We can't for time, and also because it's such a big subject as we start to go into the ins and outs of sex, no pun intended, that it's a, you know, it deserves respect, it deserves time to be given to it. But we'll make a little bit more headway today, hopefully, on this sort of subject within relationships, because this is really reflective of our relationship with ourself and the relationship with our environment as well, and how receptive we are to our environment and to the urges of our environment. Because those of you that have seen my language talk and have gone about goo and all the rest of it, really the point is that the environment, the living space of your environment, is the thing which takes the role of your partner if you don't have an actual partner. So that's, we've not really had time to go into that, but a few people mentioned a few points during the break about not being in relationships, what happens then, sort of thing. And it's very much about paying attention to your environment and the urges that it kind of demonstrates and gives you to. We can't really go into too much detail tonight, sadly, but hopefully we can make a bit more headway on this sort of thing. So the challenge that we're up against is that men who are out of balance on the feminine side have a challenge where they are then up against an over-masculinised female, which is really messy, as most of you will have experienced, because, you know, both sexes have been judged extremely harshly by the other. And it puts us in a very difficult place, because most of us are sexist in some way. And we might not like to admit it, we may not even be aware of it, but it will express itself somewhere in our life. Do people relate to that in some way? Okay. And it's because of our conditioning, you can't do anything about it. This is what I mean about gender slapping us silly and ruining all, you know, well, not ruining, but often our lack of awareness of gender and its flows can lead to the breakdown or failure of relationships that could otherwise have succeeded, just because of our inattentiveness to the flows going on there. And it's because in any relationship, there's actually three things going on. There's three elements at play, not two. So you have you, you have your partner, you guys, so then there's you and all your crap, right? There's you and all your baggage, all your rubbish, all your nonsense, and then there's all your great stuff, your growth, your direction, all the rest of it. So there's you and your crap, I'll put that here, you and your, I'll just call it stuff to be more neutral. You and your stuff, and partner, and their stuff. But then, you've got the relationship between the two of you, which actually is an entity in its own right, okay? Because, relationship. Okay? So, sometimes, you're looking at you and your stuff, or dealing with you and your stuff. Or other times, you may be helping your partner out with their stuff. But that isn't necessarily feeding your relationship. Your relationship is something else. You know when they talk about working on your relationship? Most people don't even know what that means. They don't realise there's an additional entity at play. You could almost consider it an entity. It's a bit like... it's quantum, for want of a better term, which is, as soon as you have two objects, there's immediately the third element, which is the relationship between the two. And it's always relative, you know, and it's the relativity of gender is something we talked about, I talked about to a few people during the break, because things change, you know, things are relatively, you know, as I said earlier, sometimes I'll be in the male role, sometimes I'll be in the female role, and that could change 15 times in a minute. You know, it's all very relative. Now, what tends to happen in relationships is that people forget to feed the relationship, and what you have is two perfectly good people, fine individuals, both managing to progress their own paths perfectly well, but creating a crap relationship that just goes stagnant over time. Does it sound familiar to anybody? Most of us have tasted it in some way or another. And it's actually because we've not been aware of this other element. But this is because of our stuff. It gets in the way. And the journey of gender is the journey of connecting on all of the levels, on each of the aspects with appropriate gender flows. That's why not many of us have what we would consider to be an ideal or perfect relationship, because there's so much going on. We're immensely complex beings. But I want to draw this. And if you could consider, so yin yang, yeah, everyone's familiar with that logo. That's not particularly, I actually prefer to use this symbol to denote gender. It's all about balls and penetration of matter and all the rest of it, because this is really what we're doing in an energetic sense. All of you are fragments of soul, energy, whatever you want to call it, penetrating the substance of this planet. Okay? The planetary this vehicle is feminine relative to that penetration of spirit. Okay, so gender is everywhere, it's absolutely everywhere. It's involved in all the relationships and all the interactions. So I prefer this symbol, which I go on about in other events. But this is one that everybody's familiar with. And what's interesting is everybody's okay with, yeah, the male bit, yeah, the female bit, brilliant, brilliant. But there's a defining line between the two, isn't there? What about this container bit? And that's the relationship. And what's really interesting is that when we are comfortable in our maleness and our femaleness, or whatever, everything's fine, it's all right, it's brilliant. But as we get a bit closer to, where things aren't quite so clear, we have a thing called gender tension that kicks in. And gender tension is where, have you ever found yourself getting in a really heated debate with your partner, and then you find out later you're both talking about exactly the same thing and you completely agree, but you're actually looking at it from completely different points of view, and at the time, you just could not see that. Does that sound familiar to some? Yeah, that's gender tension, and we're up against it all the time, and it is what kills relationships, because we can't step out of that to see what's going on and say, okay, this is where things aren't quite so clear. Because when does left become right? When does hot become cold? When does up become down? It's all relative. And it's the same for gender as well, because obviously the big subject we haven't talked about tonight is homosexuality, gender confusion, what gives rise to transgender and things like that. And it's all to do with the fact that what's happened in the last century or so is this is being kind of scribbled out a bit. And we're in the position of having to redefine it, but nobody's told us. And so the living challenge we're all going through is the redefinition of what it is to be a man and what role or function that is, and what it is to be a woman and what role or function that is, if indeed there is one. And there is no map for this, there is no rule. We are the living manifestation of trying to work that out. Your relationship is that. And it depends on how attentive you are to it, whether it will flourish and do well, or whether it will stagnate just through being starved and you'll just drift apart, which is the most common thing we'll see. What we're seeing now is that because people are getting a handle on their stuff, is that split-ups are a bit more amicable than they may have been 5 or 10 years ago, when it may have finished with lots of flailing and arguing and throwing clothes out the window or whatever. These days people are having much more amicable splits, but it's still a lot to do with not feeding the relationship. And we have to ask ourselves, do we want intimate, close, sharing relationships still when we are these super enlightened, awakened beings? Do you still want somebody to share with? Do you still want somebody to connect with? If you do, then it's something we have to turn our attention to. If you don't, it's fine. There's nothing wrong with that, because it's all part of being whole. You don't need anybody else. But I think any of you who have been in any long-term relationships will learn and know that at some point, it becomes a choice to be with somebody. You have to choose. There's no perfect anything. Does anybody relate to that? You hit that point in some long-term relationships where you realise, actually, do you know what? I choose to be with you. I think they're the ones that can actually stand the test of time, is when you actually accept and face and embrace that choice. So, we're up against this sort of graying line here. Now, I went off on a thread there, as I normally do, and forgot where I jumped ship. I'm going to go back to this now. You and your stuff, partner and their stuff, masculine, feminine, mother, boy. Let me just write it back on there again. So, if we say this is the guy side over here, then put boy, man. Okay. So the endemic challenge that we're up against is the fact that our culture and society have kind of made it a bit of a giggle to blur out the lines of gender role and all the rest of it. But this is a good thing, because it's forcing us to redefine it with our new awareness and awakening. It's forcing us to do it consciously rather than accidentally or inadvertently or anything like that. But we have a bit of a problem, and that is that we are all vulnerable and fragile beings that have all been very, very hurt in our life, usually from childhood onwards, to the point where we are not okay with our vulnerability and our fragility. And for a woman to be in her femaleness leaves her feeling very vulnerable and fragile to celebrate her femininity in its fullness. What not a lot of people know is that for a man to be in his maleness is a very vulnerable and fragile place to be. But I'm talking about real maleness, not a boy in a man's body. And I am presenting a very, very challenging point to people tonight, and that is a lot of people have castigated, even men are sexist against men now, do you know what I mean? We turn our back on our own because we have thrown out the baby with the bathwater behaviourally because we bought into the story that patriarchy is the source of all the ills of the world and that, you know, patriarchy is responsible for this, that and the other, we need to return to divine feminine energies, blah, blah, blah. I actually challenge that because I think it's a symbiotic problem. And by symbiotic I mean you cannot say it was one and not the other. Both are equally culpable. There is no blame. But everybody's attachment to their sexism and to blame is causing massive problems in relationships because we can't get rid of that resentment. For women, the sense of duty or obligations and things like that. And for man, the sense of, you know, whatever it is that it brings up for him in terms of having to go and perform or, you know, make money or blah, blah, blah. All these traditional, stereotypical roles. And we've got to get rid of the role. What we've done is we chuck the role and the energy out, not realising that actually, you know, we need to transform that energy. So now for a man, what most men will do to identify with their gender is, you know, football, alcohol, gaming, Xbox and things like that. Does it sound familiar? Yeah, this is actually because they've not really been given any other sense of identity of what it is to be a man. And there's a real challenge there for them because these are actually all expressions of the boy, which is the female, not the man. And I suggest the same is true for so-called patriarchy. And that is that actually, that isn't maleness. It's just boys playing. Now the problem that we've got is, now patriarchy's been given all the blame, hasn't it? Yeah? Now what's interesting is that at the time that some dictator got up and said, right, all of you lot, I'm going to do this. As soon as the whole population accept that, the problem is they're all too much in their feminine. You see that? That's our problem, people. Our problem is we have accepted too much what others are bringing to our community in terms of the poison foods, the poison medicines, the poison products and all the rest of it that we're just accepting. Yeah, you can poison the kids, keep going, it's all right. Yeah, I don't mind, I'll swallow a bit myself. We accept that, we tolerate that. We're all over-feminized. It's not, you know, it's an incredible thing that, I know I talked about over-masculinization earlier, but the funny thing is, in one extent as well, both of them are out of balance. We accept too much and we're pointing out the wrong things. You know, that's the thing, and it's like, why tonight I want to come in and say, right, actually I want to draw some attention back to roots and back to basics here, because of the whole mental excitation thing. And that reminded me, yeah, because I think the thing is, we want our mental excitation fed because it's nice and safe and it's comfortable, it's energising, it's hope-fulfilling, and it takes us away from our vulnerability and our fragility. But I think it's actually our very vulnerability and fragility that we need to get through this, because it's the thing that our humanity is fundamentally attached to. So here's what happens. So because it's fragile for a man to stand up with his authentic self, to be the man in his community and what that means and all the rest of it. And a modern man, you know, to be balanced and blah, 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 there's a real vulnerability and fragility there. So it's easier for him to be in his boy because that's strong. He's been that his whole life. It's safe, it's reliable. Okay? You can rely on your boy because he's always been that. Whereas the man, that's a new identity. It's a new role. And for women, much easier to be in the mother, to be in that masculine, defensive, protective state, to not let people close, to manage the boundary, blah, 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 patrol it incessantly, to not let anybody in, to not show that. So there we are, both men and women, spattering our opposite gender as being our core personality. Okay, it's a bit of a grasp that, but actually for most of us, we put our opposite out there. Most women in here, the personality is actually their masculine. Most men in here, your personality is actually your feminine, for most of you. You're on the journey of externalising and being the other, and that's the process we're all on as we become our authentic human self. And that takes us to our fragility. Now, here's the interesting thing, and that is that we were all tricked, and we tricked ourselves. We assumed that by being in our vulnerable, fragile self, that meant we could be hurt. But we got it the wrong way around. The problem is, if you put all your impenetrable, defensive stuff out here, and somebody gets through it, then they're through to your soft centre. They're through to your vulnerability, your fragility, and all the rest of it. And yes, you can be hurt. Yes, you will feel wounded. And yes, it will be unfettered. Okay? And you will want to put the boundary up and make it even better next time. So that now you're all masters of your space, where nobody can hurt you unless you let them, sort of thing. And, you know, you might not open the doors quite so open, quite so wide the next time round because of that. But what we don't realise is it's the wrong way around. Because if your vulnerability and fragility is actually on the outside, what's on the inside? Your die-hard, indestructible core. Everybody see that? It's a bit of a difficult grasp, but it's just, again, a suggestion to consider is that the result isn't what we think in terms of being in our vulnerable, fragile self. Now, people talk about peace as being this thing, right, that you can work for or fight for or whatever, or stand for. And peace is being presented as being the opposite of war. But it actually isn't. Okay? And I'm doing this because actually war is like the uncontained masculine in the world. The uncontained sort of masculine urge to change, control, whatever, blah, 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 that manifests as war. Now, if I was to do that as a set of scales, okay? So here's a set of scales. Okay. If I put war on one side, in fact, no, war's on this side. If I put war on this side, peace is actually here. Peace is an effect. Peace is a result. It's passive, isn't it? How can you fight for peace? What an oxymoron that is. You know, it's a nonsense statement. Peace is an effect. The opposite of war is actually raw. Okay? War and raw. And by raw, I mean consider a newborn infant, female menstrual cycle, parenthood. These are raw. And just you just have to consider each of those things. Consider what I mean by raw. And the only success anybody's had in the peace movement has not been because they stood for peace, but it's been because they were raw in doing so. They were standing with their authentic, human, vulnerable, fragile self. But they were pointing out what was wrong. See what I mean? How these things work symbiotically. Now, so for me, the way you get peace is by balancing the war within us, the fight against whatever, with our rawness, which is our feminine. For all of us, that rawness. You can apply that to anything. You see raw turning up all over the place these days, don't you? And it's because it's actually something we need to turn our attention to. Because again, if we wind right back to the beginning and say, okay, just say the system did collapse, power, phone, blah, blah, went off, would you feel raw? Would you feel exposed? Would you feel vulnerable and fragile? I would. Now the thing is, how would I then be going out to speak to my neighbours because my codename buddy on a forum isn't available because there's no petrol to fill my car up to go and see him? And this is the challenge of relating, I think, we're up against. Because now when we walk out our door, it's not all, you know, we're not stepping out into a nationalised community. We're stepping out into a multinational community. We may not even speak the same language as our neighbour. Would you feel raw trying to relate to them? Would you be standing there trying to point out, or would you be willing to listen to their point of view as well? I don't have the answer. I'm suggesting that I think these are the challenges we're really up against, and that when these big mental bubbles burst or when they don't manifest, I still think they're the same challenges we'll have up against us. And I think the stories will continue. You know, there's tons of stories out there. There's loads that will keep pouring in. You know, there'll be new ones to replace the old ones that die off. And just like we enjoy the thrill of reading the news and looking at the headlines, we'll happily buy into those new stories as well. But will we have got back to this foundational stuff? And obviously, the relationship side of it is just one element in amongst everything else you've got to take on board, but I think it's a very neglected one. And in fact, in all of my work, those of you that see me talk about language, sign, public trust and all the rest of it, I've always wanted to do the gender work first. I've always thought it was the most important. I've always thought it was the thing which would give the maximum benefit to everybody ASAP. Because if you can restore a sense of humanity and community in the house, in your family, and all the rest of it, then surely that's a thing worth working towards or working on. And when you're dealing with something as powerful as gender that affects every communication that we have, I think the potential benefits are massive. And remember, we've still not gone over the model yet. We've still not even got there. We're still just looking at the periphery. This is just the beginning. And hopefully I've got your attention now to realise that there is something in this area, there's something in this subject matter worth paying attention to. Now, let me just see what I'm going to sort of do to finish before we see. So yeah, this isn't people like things like the People's Public Trust or whatever because it's like a solution, you know. This isn't a solutions talk. I don't have a solution to this one. I just have an invitation, I have a suggestion. You know, but I am a guy like you other guys in here facing the challenge of my gender. You know, and you know, the ladies out there, you have the challenge of yours as well. But I'm just trying to say that it is something that I think we need to work on. I'll be running a pile of gender events over the next few months in the run-up to the Venus transit just to provide opportunity for people who might want to address it. So if anybody's interested in that, I'll talk about that in a bit. But can I just check where we are for time? Because I want to know when we should be sort of wrapping up.
You've got about another 40 minutes.
I've got 40 minutes? Mm. Oh, that's fine. Right. Okay, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to fill 40 minutes now because I need to draw a line on this so that they don't go too far. Okay, sorry? Yeah. Okay, so. In terms of what can we actually do in our relationships then? When we find ourselves in the boy or in the mother, what do you do? There's no easy answer to that. Because each relationship you have, every one of them, remember earlier I talked about the different yous that you had, the you with your kids, the you with your partner, the you at work, all the rest of it. Each of those relationships is a little microclimate in its own right, a little microcosm of the macrocosm, a little micro world, as it were. And nobody knows what is actually going on inside those little micro worlds except you and the other people in it. Any onlooker cannot see the truth, not unless they're extremely insightful. Because only you're aware of all the real nuances, the little subtleties of body language, the little nuances of eye contact or brushing off or all the rest of it. And we're all hypersensitive to it. Every one of us is fully aware of it. So, what was I talking about? Test, pop quiz. It's good, it's getting late now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, pop quiz, where was I?
Our own intricacies, our own internal small processes. And
maybe from the mother or the boy.
You guys are experienced being around me, aren't you? Maybe the plenty of talks. I thought it was funny that they spoke up there, but I still don't think that's the point I was at yet. Yeah, mother and boy, you. Oh yeah, microclimates. That was it, little ecosystems. So basically, every relationship you've ever been in has been its own little micro world, a past life experience. Because the world you're in now isn't the world that was. And the way you behaved in that relationship is different to how you behaved before and different to how you behaved after. Does everybody agree?
Mm-hmm.
It's funny that, isn't it? And there may be things that you did in one relationship that you've never done before and you've never done since. But for some reason it was there. Somebody's laughing away in the back there. may sound familiar to some of you as well. And it's because of the nuances of what's actually going on in gender. So the point is, what to do when you're in the boy or in the mother? I don't know. You're the only one who knows what's going on. And this is responsibility. This is about saying, can you own your space and own your world, the things that you've created for yourself or attracted to yourself? So what micro worlds have you attracted to yourself just now? What are you surrounded by? What messages are you being presented with? Because you're the one who has to decode it. You're the one who has to unfathom it and kind of get to the bottom of it to realise what the way out is. Now, or the way forward, sorry, rather than the way out. The way out kind of implies some kind of getaway. There is no get out. That's the point. You either make it or the relationship fails. That's it, or the relationship ends and you move on. And this is a representation of what's going on within yourself. Somebody early on was asking me about the whole world wars thing, and you know, so was I saying that the wars were a positive thing, or that they were somehow triggered in some way? I think there's many levels playing themselves out at the same time, you know, and I think that's true of all things. And actually, what's going on in our relationships and in our life is there's actually a few worlds happening at the same time. There's your experience as the personality going through it, and then there's the experience of your soul or higher self that's going on at the same time. And how it, the higher you, the objective you, views your experiences is completely different to how you feel them at the time. So if any of you had really horrible moments for your personality that afterwards you were like, do you know what? I got loads out of that. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And this is where, again, I've not done a lot of gender events because it really pushes me out of the comfort zone. Because when you start to talk about things like violence, war, assault, rape, things like that, which happen as you start to get into gender and sexual conversations, it can be very challenging. Because for the personality going through them, they're immensely traumatic. Of course they are. They're horrendous. But the thing is, that is not to say that the soul views it in the same way. So you have all these people going on about, you know, oh, how can there be a God if there's war and all this sort of stuff going on? And it's because people are viewing it as the personality going through the experience. They're not looking at the bigger picture. They're not looking at the other aspects of themselves. They will view the situation completely differently. And this is what's going on in your relationships. So what's happening all the time is there's actually more characters at play, believe it or not. Because there's you, your stuff, and the greater you. There's your partner, their stuff, and the greater them. And sometimes those behaviours that you're not aware of are actually your soul taking over for a little bit to demonstrate or to create a lesson. It's almost like an agreement. The people that have treated you the worst in your life are probably your best friends. Because who else would you trust to give you that kind of lesson that could push you so close to the edge and treat you so badly? Who else would you trust but somebody that was actually, that you have the utmost respect for? I feel that about my ex-partners. I have the utmost respect for them. Because they're clearly my best friends, because I wouldn't let anybody else do that to me. Do you know what I mean? In its own sense. So this is what's happening in these microclimates, is that there's much more going on. And the objective, the goal of becoming whole, becoming the self, the being and the coming, working together, that's a process of cosmic lovemaking that takes place throughout your life. Of a gradual feeling of close connection and oneness to feeling distant and lost and abandoned. Which is just the ins and outs of life, which is all about gender everywhere. And the goal, well, there's a number of culmination points along the route. I mentioned earlier the coming of the soul. The coming of the soul is generally the point where doubt is gone and you know why you were here, you know why you are here, what you're going to get on with and all the rest of it, and then a whole new stage of life continues. And so it's like there's two stages in life which are denoted by gender. One is the will to know. The will to know. So the will to know dominates people's lives for the first period. For some people, it's still there because you don't know yet. You haven't answered the big questions about you, who you are, why you're here, what you're all about. In terms of that be yourself thing at the beginning, you're still finding yourself. And that is a position worth celebrating and embracing because it's the journey. Fabulous. But then when you know, there's a second stage that takes over, which is the will to be. The will to be. Which is the will to manifest all the things that you know. And so some of you here will be in the stage of the will to be, where you're wrestling against all the stuff that you know, but you haven't managed to manifest it yet, because you haven't resolved you and your stuff. Yeah? Okay. So.
Sorry, carry on.
Carry on, is that all right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Honestly, you should see the faces I get to see. No, don't look round. Don't look round.
What's it?
Okay.
Is that one reason why are bad for you. We were talking about this to the lads the other day. I was going, if you want to chat a girl up, just be horrible to her. It's horrible to her. And we were laughing, but it is true. When you, if you were nice, if men are nice, you don't want the support. You want somebody that's horrible to you.
Why do you want somebody to talk? It's a very good question. And they were getting really interested. All of these issues to do with the war and the raw within us, and about us and our stuff, and all of it, I mean, it's a massive journey of self-mastery, that one. It's about the managing of the flailing limbs, okay? So does everybody know what I mean when I say flailing limbs?
No.
So basically, right, so when you were born, every one of you, I'll demonstrate this on the table as usual. Excuse me, my here's things. Honestly, you lot in Birmingham, what you did to me. Only because it's this time of night, and I've had enough, so I'm going to lie and flail on the table for a bit, everybody. Excuse me. So, when you arrived in this life, you were like this. Flailing limbs is what I mean. Does anybody disagree? Okay. So, what was really interesting was that when you arrived, you didn't have much body awareness. That's why those limbs and them were doing their stuff. And with intent, in the space of a year, most of you had gone from kicking and flailing like that to being able to walk. Purely by intent, purely by observation. Hats off, that's incredible. How did you do that? You don't even know. It's great, it's worth acknowledging you did it, it's amazing. It took you 2 years to make a talk. Equally amazing, because you did that just by listening and watching. Nobody showed you how to make, do all this complex stuff with your throat and your tongues and all the rest of it. Now, the journey that we're on is a journey of the mastery of the bodies. Because what you did was, you had the physical body there, and it was kicking and flailing, and now you're all dexterous wielders. You can all wave your left hand, you know, you can catch moving objects, you can do all this sort of stuff. It took you years to do that. But then when your emotional body wakes up at puberty, okay, it's been really being through its gestation prior to that. When it wakes up in puberty and properly becomes a body in its own right, which it is, because the space in which you feel things like happiness, sadness, guilt and shame is not the same space that I poke your arm. Okay, poke your leg down. Poke it. Poke your leg. Does that feel the same as feeling happy or sad? It's not, is it? It's different. And this is what dimensions are. This is what bodies are. They're about qualitative difference. Think of a banana. Right, that quality of thinking is different from poking your leg or feeling sad, isn't it? And these are the qualitative difference of the bodies that you use every day. So when your emotional body wakes up at puberty, it does the same thing the physical did. It's kicking and it's flailing. And it's doing guilt, shame, love, self-consciousness, all that stuff you went through as a teenager. But all that help and support you had with your physical body, oh, come on, well done, oh, you're doing well, yeah, your first step. Oh, you're burping and farting, that's brilliant. You know, where is that support for when you are going through your first love or self-consciousness of having your hair picked on or your clothes picked on or things like that, if that ever happened to you? The support matrix isn't there. So what happens is instead of being a dexterous wielder of your emotional limbs, we are instead flapping and flailing. And this is what I mean by our stuff. I mean the flapping and flailing of our uncontrolled, unmastered emotional and mental aspects that attack both us and those around us. Because none of us here are masters, are we? Not fully of those bodies, I don't believe. And that is therefore something that we all have to work on. That's the journey of self-mastery. But then what I'm just adding into that, which, okay, some of you already knew that because I've done it before, but now I'm just adding another thing into the pot there, which is obviously the whole gender thing. That's another, almost like a limb that we maybe weren't aware of, that's at play all the time, that we have to incorporate into our very delicate ongoing balancing act in all our sort of interactions and relationships. So, I still haven't got onto obviously what we do in that situation of boy-mother relationship, maybe communicating not happening. And I've painted around it quite a lot there because I can't show you how to walk. But you've proven you already did, and so did I. Okay, so that's good. We've both shown that we can do that bit of intent, yeah? I couldn't show you how to talk. I can't show you how to do this. But just like I might be able to point out, hey, you've got an arm there. Have you noticed how it's been doing this? That's what I'm trying to allude to with this stuff. And I can do nothing else but let the master within you that actually did, by intent, learn to walk and become a dexterous wielder, be able to take on the journey of emotional mastery and mental exploration. You've all undertaken that personally, by yourself, otherwise you wouldn't be here. So that means you're capable and able to turn your attention to your own situations, and that's really all I can do with this. And so quite a funny thing is, you know, we have this, I think we've got a big problem in our culture, and that is the culture, a thing that I call Messiah complex. Okay, what we have is we have people who are putting themselves out there as quote-unquote saviours, or people who believe that about themselves. You've got loads of people who have gone through Messiah complex in recent decades, and some people have been open and honest about it, like, you know, David Icke, David Shaler, even Terence Trent D'Arby, all the rest of it, all these, and Bill Hicks, all these people have claimed in some way or another to be, you know, the second coming, or you know, the Son of God or something like that. That's absolutely fine, because that's about Christ consciousness within each of us. But what we don't realise is there's another side to Messiah complex, and it's the one that's kicking us all up the backside and we're not aware of it. And I only became aware of it about it in the last 3 weeks. It's partly what fueled me to do this. And it is that despite all the stuff that you all know and learn, and all that you've learned in the last few years, how much of it are you actually acting on? And so that then means, okay, so which part of us isn't listening? What's going on there? Which part of our authority isn't following what guidance we've been given? Now, you have to answer that yourself. Now, what's interesting though is that the reason a lot of people aren't acting is because they're not aware that they're waiting for somebody else to do it. And I only spotted it since I've started doing this people's public trusting the last couple of years, and it's done my head in. And it's been where people will come along, they'll hear stuff and they'll be like, that's great, hope somebody's going to do something about that. Or, hey, look, they're doing that, I can't get involved right now, I don't have time, but that's all right, they're saving the world, brilliant. I can enjoy it and carry on with my life. And it's actually the part, Messiah complex, the part of us that's waiting for a saviour. It's waiting for somebody else to do it. And I think that is what we have got to kick into touch this year. That's what all these big story bubbles are about. Benjamin Fulford, anybody? You know, the Benevolent White Dragon Society, alien intervention coming to go and show us the way, all these big massive story bubbles of promised saviours that everybody's waiting for in different forms. It's like there ain't no saviour that's going to come and bail us out of how are you going to talk to your neighbour when things fall apart. There ain't no saviour that can do that. And it's the same for this and your relationships. I can't stand it, you know, heal thy relationships. Brilliant, I'm going to come along, I'm going to hear how to heal my relationships. Well, you won't. What you'll hear about is what you've heard, basically. But other than that, all I can do is say, well, do you know what? I respect and honour and recognise your capacity. It's over to you. I'd rather try and empower you in that respect. So, we're pretty much done for tonight, because really, other than this, I'd have to start going into the whole gender model itself, which would take another 6 hours. So I don't really want to do that. But what I will say is that we'll take questions in just a minute, but I'm happy to come back to talk about this a bit more. I'm happy if any of you want to come and talk about it. If any of you want to talk about your personal relationship situations, which really is where it is realised, because this is all the abstract stuff, the rest of it can only be realised by us talking about the living situations you face, because only you can be honest about it, and that requires a working format. This isn't a working format, this is me presenting to you. It needs a workshop. So if you're interested in that, me and my partner do couple counselling or one-to-one stuff. So I'll do it if you're a male, she'll do it if you're a female, or we'll do it collectively together. That's something you can arrange for as a private session. We do have workshops coming up to celebrate and create opportunity for people. So I actually have here 20 invitations. The private invitation, so there is only this many, that's it, for workshops on the gender model, looking at your living situations and how to apply it and all the rest of it. If anybody's interested, there's dates on the 31st of March and the 1st of April. They're the first ones, there will be more after that, but at the minute, you're very welcome to come and have a look, and If you want to take these, that's fine. It's not a flyer though, so there is only 20 of these. So please only take one if you're interested in coming along and you want to put a deposit down or something like that, but you're welcome to come and have a look at it. Other than that, I have my usual bits and bobs some of you are familiar with, which is obviously my GUIS booklets about the first word and our environment. I've got the Sounds for the Soul CD, which is more about the language stuff and using sound. Some of you are aware of that. I've also got a couple of DVDs, which... I'll just dig them out here, sorry. I'm just hearing that massive silence of people that are waiting for more and I talk to wrap it up. You just give me a second. It's always like this at the talk, it's just like busted open minds and just I just leave you like that. I do apologise, but hey, that's just the way it is. At least I'm not giving you any false promises. So, I've got the God Conspiracy, A Devil's Agenda DVD, which is about this goo thing and about God and the Church. And I've got Beyond the Free Man, Sovereignty, What It Means, and the People's Public Trust, which was a talk I gave at St. Anne's afterwards at Occupy. You're welcome to come and have a look at them. Please come and have a browse. I'm happy to take some questions. If we take just a 5 minute break, digestive break, and then we'll do questions and after discussion, if that's all right. If anyone's got any announcements to make as well, that'd be ideal.
We've got about 20 minutes, so if you want to talk amongst yourselves or ask questions,
yeah. I'm just going up to the loo, and also mailing list if people are interested in finding out about future dates or whatever. Please come and talk. I hope you got something out of this evening. Thank you very much.
Sure,
for your time.
Thanks, it's an interesting paradigm. I might as well tell you a little personal story.
Very quickly.
Sorry, I envisaged that. Was that just last year? My son never does his homework, so I ran up the stairs at one night, Sunday night this is, and it's about 10 o'clock and he's just remembered and all that. And I went upstairs and I said, you never do your homework. I didn't hit him, he's massive. You never do your fucking homework. And as soon as I said it, I knew it. And that meant I already knew it, which then meant at 6 o'clock, I should have went and done it. I should have sat with him and generated the homework, and instead I let him get to 10 o'clock. To enter into a conflict so I could go up and score a point, 1-0, because I knew you wouldn't do it. And that's an interesting paradigm, to be able to see the words that are scoring the point, and we all do it with our missuses as well. I knew you wouldn't fucking do that. I rang my missus last year, and I said, I'm locked out, you silly fecker, why didn't you leave a key under the mat? I said that to her, and as I was saying that, I went, well, I could have left the freaking key on the mat. So I'd only rang you to score a point. And if you start seeing your relationships in that point scoring thing, you have to question sometimes the voice in the head that says, get her back, because she's dropped a clanger here, and you're in the right. That's the worst. As soon as you hear that voice, you know you're buggered. Because halfway through the argument, she points out in brilliant the erudite style. All the failings in your... You know, we're all doing this. So we have to be careful of starting to score points and keeping the score and saying, I'll get you back. And even with our children, of setting up a conflict, don't you fucking dare do that. Instead of saying, in a minute, I need you to do this. You know, the empowerment thing, these are interesting things because our parents didn't know it, but we have a knowledge of it and therefore we can put it into action. That was just killer thing, right?
Thank you. I'll give you one tip that is useful for this, that is generic. So, guys, if you're in the boy and there's issues going on in the relationship and all the rest of it, or there's things you want to address, rule number one, do not talk to your good lady about it. She doesn't want to hear about your nonsense detail. She's heard enough about it. She probably thinks you're a pain in the ass going on about it all the time. You know, you guys, ladies, have you ever thought about your guy? Bloody hell, he's going on about that. That's obvious, things like that. This is all because of the gender force. One of the qualities of maleness, which is addressed when we look at the model, which obviously can't do tonight, but one of the things is that you have to demonstrate by example. The man has to demonstrate by example, not by talking about it. So you have to do it. That's the challenge of the male, basically, the pain in the backside. But yeah, you've got to do it instead of talking about it. Women, if you find yourself in the mother, and you're feeling a bit resentful about your guy, or a bit bitter, or a bit angry, or whatever, or judging him and, you know, whatever, you've got to ease up a bit. You've got to realise, actually, you're up against the endemic problems of our times. You're up against a hyper masculinized aspect of self, and you're just going to have to learn to ease off a bit and, you know, give a bit more space. One of the biggest things, that's what we'll finish on, is space. Brilliant! We'll come around to something at the end. Space, final frontier. Everybody heard that before? Okay, well it is. And it's an interesting thing because what we have to do is give each other space for our stuff. It's not personal what's going on. It's about your partner. So one of the things we're doing is we're judging them because they're dealing with their stuff. Right? And so we end up getting into this wrestling match there. Now what we have to remember is when you first connected with your partner, you had that magical, beautiful, spiritual connection, yeah? Doesn't matter whether it's a traditional or a homosexual relationship, it doesn't matter. We didn't get a chance to talk about homosexuality tonight, but that is covered in this model as well. But one of the things is you had that initial taste. Now that's the core that is still there. All the rest is flapping and flailing. Okay, all the rest of it is them and their stuff and all and whatnot. But we take it all too personally. We don't give each other the space to heal. We're not gentle enough with each other. We don't give each other enough time, enough patience and tolerance. If you can just do that, you're on it. And I think we're in the times now where we have to address space as an element. So again, just to wrap up on an elemental journey. So, you know, we have the physical body, which is very much represented by Earth, yeah? We're actually built in a map of the planet. We're built the same. So we have Earth as our foundation. Sitting on the Earth, we have the water, which is our emotions, which are contained by the land, obviously, which is our flesh. After that, we have our fire, which is actually the lower mind. So fire is actually the element of the third chakra, as some of you may well be aware. And then beyond that, we have the air of the lungs, which is also the heart space. Now, what's interesting about the heart and the air as an element that matches the heart is that the air is everywhere in the planet, isn't it? And there's only one air, just like there's only one love. And with our heart space, we are all intrinsically connected. And that's why right now when I go, okay, we have the illusion that I'm separate from you, don't we? But there we are. I've just breathed some air right into my deepest core, past all my defences, all my shields, everything, right into here. And you can breathe in the very same air molecules. The sense of separation is nothing but an illusion. We're like fish in a sea that have forgotten what water looks like. But the funny thing is, that's just in the planetary sphere. The atomosphere, where there are atoms. We've got atmosphere, but I think it's the wrong way around. It's the atomosphere. But what's outside the atmosphere? What's next? It's space. And space is what's called the cosmic womb. And it's the thing that we've forgotten about. And what people don't realise is that on the journey from lower to higher self is that as soon as you pass out of the realms of the lower self into the realms of the heart and beyond, is that the other centres automatically open in sequence. And humans have already started to have their heart stimulated. None of you would be here if you hadn't. Thing is, though, now what we're facing is space. And I think this is what's been, this is part of the cosmic dredge of the last sort of 8 months or so, and what's causing relationships to kind of drift and all the rest of it is that we've been faced with the challenges of our own space. For guys, that's manifested in abandonment issues. You know, and issues of abandonment, or feeling abandoned, or lost in space, and all this sort of stuff, and being okay with their space. For women, it manifests in other ways. I don't know, I'm not a woman, I can't give you the soundbite for it. I'm not going to be another man that tries to tell women how to be a woman, you know. But I think space is probably the greatest tool that I can kind of generalise and give you to go away with tonight is patience, tolerance, space. Recognise this stuff going on. Recognise that if your partner has just got some of their stuff going on, that it's nothing to do with you, that it's about them and their stuff. Maybe you might want to help out, but without taking it personally. And the most important thing of all is that when we think we are being the gender teacher, and the one pointing out is generally when we're not, and actually the real soul lessons are given when we're just being ourselves. Oh, anyway, thank you. Is there any questions? Yes.
Yeah, you mentioned the different models of each one. I mean, there's the thing about the societal pressure, isn't there? And I look at that comment, self-appointed guardians of the system, you know, but I think we're self-appointed guardians of each other. And when I drop my kids off at school and you listen to the women, or you're at the pub and you listen to the men, you know, you've got that thing going on, haven't you? You've got that whole self-appointed thing. And I tell you what, I've always broken above it, always. I've always, whether I've been searching for a feminine or a man, I've always looked above it, you know. And I don't know why, it's just me. I've always been a watcher of people and all that, and I guess you're the same.
But you still not feel the endemic obstacles. You're still not free of the endemic obstacles. That's what I meant at the beginning by endemic obstacles. It's the stuff that's just in our culture. It's just there. And that's what I mean about, I think it's quite important that we buy this time. We use this time of the Venus transit. Let's use it. It's there. You know, and I don't just mean it in terms of relationships. It's in terms of, you know, the celebration of our own space, of our own creativity, of our own vocational contribution. That's very much what I see as being part of this time. Is owning our space and what that actually means. And I've seen it just come out a lot, just even in the last few weeks, you know, poems dropping into my inbox from people, and I'm just like, you what? But it's brilliant. I see it as part of this sort of Venusian force that's coming in. And just in terms of, so the reason I mentioned that is because I think we have a time at the moment where the pressure and influence of those endemic obstacles is reduced. So I think we've got a few months throughout this year in the summer to make the most out of looking at our relationships, healing our relationships, paying attention to them in whatever way that we can, because I think the pressure valve is off on all that endemic stuff. And it's just an invitation, that's just my intuitive take on it. I only came across it in the last few weeks, that's why I changed all the events to this. It's a suggestion, you can take from it what you will based on your own sense of what's going on. I will say that all this gender stuff and the whole gender model stuff, it actually plays itself out differently in the different relationships. So how it plays out with kids is different from how it plays out with your partners, it's different from friends, it's different from business, but it's still in business. And then most importantly is the relationship with yourself, because it plays itself out slightly differently there as well. And that is something that we look at in depth if you want to come along and either have one-to-ones on it or do a workshop on it where we can really get into the ins and outs of it. What is that term again? That's what it's about though. It is. It's the ins and outs, yeah.
Sorry, just about kind of the role of kind of religious archetypes informing a kind of, you know, how we should all be. And, you know,
yeah.
One of the things that came up for me,
yeah,
in quite an interesting thing with one of my friends who, you know, had an affair and it was all gone, you know, in certain ways, and the concept of blame and everything and how it, and we were sort of trying to take a kind of step back and kind of see it in the sense of, you know, the morality that is sort of inbred in us from, you know, from such a,
yeah.
And I don't know about Aldous Huxley, The Island.
Yeah.
If you know that book. But
I don't know it, but yeah.
But it was just quite interesting because actually as we're having this conversation, that was one of the books, and it was about basically an island that had a whole new way of governing society, which didn't have these moralities in it, where everyone was, it was like, because it was a community, actually no one knew who fathered the child. Everyone was considered to be in a community.
Okay.
As a kind of juxtaposed to what we have, you know, in a morality, well, church-based morality sort of society. I just wondered if you could give us a bit of insight.
Yeah, that's part of it. I mean, part of this is the reason why the church has so many issues with sexuality, is because of how they have portrayed the expression of the gender roles and the gender models. It's really important to look at this, the energy and the behaviour, okay? The best example is anger, right? Anger is the most castigated of all emotions. And it's because the first time it shows up, you're told it's not okay. So whenever you first start speaking back to your parents, like, don't speak back to me like that, blah, 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 all this sort of stuff. And so then what happens to people is, in their life, they then do anything to show that they're angry, except say, I'm angry with you because of this. So you might make a crap cup of tea. You might not invite somebody out next time. You might shout and scream. You might go dead quiet. You might storm out. But all of them are expressions of the same thing. I'm angry with you. So the same energy can give rise to 100 different manifestations. And it's the same with this. This is what we're up against. And so it's about us being honest with what has influenced us, because the church modality is one thing that's affected us. The other element is the state perception of it. So some people may have had an atheistic upbringing, might not be so exposed to the church stuff, but they'll be more exposed to sort of cultural, you know, ideas of the glamorous girl or the macho man and things like that. And there's some great work done on it. Tough Guys is a film by an American called Jackson Katz, who was an American footballer who was getting right into this whole, it's tough guys, into the whole kind of stereotyping of males and the challenges that brings up. And Killing Us Softly is an incredible series of documentaries by a woman, I can't remember her name, I do her a disservice by forgetting it, but for the last 30 years, every 10 years, she's done a new documentary on advertising images of women and what that kind of portrays and how that's changed over decades. And they're both well worth a watch, just because, again, they're part of this neglected aspect. And because it's so abstract, I can. What we have to do is we have to look at specifics. Once we've gone over the generalities, after that, in a specific situation, do we want to talk about a particular instance of paedophilia? Do we want to talk about a particular instance of, you know, for the church, you know, a relationship breakdown or whatever? These are all the things that you have to look at. It's then specific, like your relationship, your relationship, your relationship. It's about the specifics within that. We have to look at the details to see what has to play out or how it plays out. The challenges of abstract things, it's like getting into the whole intent of how do I lift my arms, you know? Very, very difficult stuff. Anybody else? Sorry, I've not a great answer.
Brilliant.
Yes?
What do you think about the order of the soulmate or life partner or one person forever then, if you're thinking about masculine and feminine, if you've got that aspect for a bit and then...
Relative. For some people it's true, for some it's not. For some people that is what they wanted to feel and experience in this life, and therefore they've set up the life map that would allow that to realise itself. For a lot of something completely different is true. There's enough room in this world for 7 million realities. There is enough room for it if we can give each other the space for it and find a way to interact. And I think there isn't a standard answer, that's the point. There's no standard answers to any of it. Why do you keep avoiding talking about it for 4 years? Okay, we'll take one more then, if anybody's got one, and then I'll open the door up here. Yes?
What is it with the women that is the...
Okay. I'm going to exert my masculinity in this instance and say, I think we're going to draw the line here, but no, go on, we'll have this one more.
The treat them mean, keep them keen.
That's what she was talking about earlier.
It's true.
Right. I can't answer that just
so
now.
Many
I can't answer
I
that
think
just
that's
now.
True for
when we go in,
alone
yeah. If we, I hate doing this because normally, you all know, I normally run over my events and all this because I'm trying to cram so much into them. But we can't answer that without going through the whole of the rest of the model, looking at the whole of sex, basically.
It just means
I think we should finish there and
thank
say
you.
Thank you very much. And we've got about 15 minutes before they want to kick us out. Check out Facebook for the gathering, which is at the end of August. There's going to be several speakers. There may even include Darren.
Darren's book, please.
Darren's book for the gathering.
Guys, anybody who wants to know about the gathering?
Thank you for coming.
Sorry. Anybody who wants to know about the gathering?